Hey guys, Jake Carlson here, host of the Modern Leadership Podcast. Are you ready to focus on amplifying your leadership superpowers? Let's go. Welcome, my friends and fellow elite achievers, to another episode of Modern Leadership. I hope that you had a terrific Labor Day, grilled some burgers, enjoyed the day off. Today's topic is hiring, and specifically some interview secrets. Unemployment is crazy low right now, so low that there are currently more job openings than there are people without jobs. This makes it tough for leaders who are out looking for good talent. Like, how do we identify our next great hire? And how do we avoid bringing a problem child onto our staff? Those kind of questions are what we want to talk about in today's episode. And to do that, I invited our guest expert, Vicki Oliver, to the show. Vicki is a career consultant, an award-winning author of 5 books on career development. Her career advice has been featured in over 801 media outlets, including the front page of the New York Times job market section, the Wall Street Journal, the New York Post, Associated Press, LA Times, Chicago Tribune, Bloomberg TV. I'm pretty sure there's not a publication out there that she hasn't been featured in. And she's also been interviewed in well over 401 local and national radio and television programs. Vicki, it's so great to have you on the podcast today. How are you?
Thank you very much for having me. I really appreciate it.
Well, you are one busy expert. I mean, you are doing a lot of writing, a lot of interviewing, a lot of things. How do you keep it all together?
I know. I feel like I should write a book about organization. That should be the next one, you know, organizing yourself.
Well, it's such an important topic because, you know, with all the distractions that we have as far as, you know, email popping up or text messages, and I know at my work we use a few different products like Asana or Evernote. We use Voxer. I mean, it seems like we're constantly inundated with stuff. How do you stay organized?
I mean, I know this is going to sound old-fashioned, but I just write a to-do list. You know, I write a to-do list, and then I mark the time that I think each task is going to take. So, you know, and then I look at it, and I say, okay, well, that's a 10-hour day. That means I'm an entrepreneur, so that means I have to get in at 9 o'clock in the morning. You know, I work backwards and try to calculate the number of hours I'm going to spend. That's how I do it.
Now, do you ever find that, like, I know when I try to do this, I always underestimate the amount of time that is going to take a project during the day. And so when I say, you know, oh, this is going to take me 30 minutes, and I look at the clock and it's been 48 minutes, do you ever have that experience?
I have it all the time, but, you know, there's a lot of time that we just waste by going on Facebook, going on LinkedIn. Like, those tools that keep us socially connected to people also are a huge time waste. So sometimes I just say, you know what, I just cannot go on social media today, and that'll save me about 2 hours right there.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. Well, Vicki, before we jump in too much, and I want to get talking about these books that you've written and specifically talk about some interview type secrets and hacks that you have. But before we do that, is there anything that we missed by way of intro? I know we talked a lot about your business. How about your personal life?
Oh, thank you for asking. I live and write in Manhattan. I do some career consulting. I meet job candidates. And I try to do it in a boot camp-like manner where I will see what their specific issue is and try to work with them on that. You know, if somebody, for example, they have bad eye contact or they keep getting interviews but then they never nail the job, that type of thing, sort of short-term, I try to identify short-term problems and help them solve them.
So the guest expert that comes in and really helps them identify, like, specifically one or two things that they need to change to enhance their ability to get hired. Now, do you work mostly with, like, high-end, like, you're in Manhattan, do you work with a lot of Wall Street or advertising executives?
Well, I am a former advertising executive. So, I mean, I know a lot of people actually in the advertising business. So I would say yes. But it's also just, you know, I write a lot of articles, I guest blog, people come to me, and I'm okay with meeting people. But the thing is, I just want to work on the issue that person has and then send them on their merry way to get a job. You know what I mean? I'm not a psychiatrist.
This is a great conversation. I'm very interested in talking to you about this, and I'll give you a little backstory. I did a lot of hiring for a law firm that I worked at, and I tend to see the good in people. And the good in people, I mean, I think that's a good quality for me, but it's a difficult quality when you're trying to hire people because all I see is the good. And every candidate that comes in the door is the perfect candidate. And then they come in the door and I realize they're not quite as good as, you know, they as advertised. So I want to jump into this. I want to talk to you about these 7 warning signs that hiring managers should look for as they interview applicants. And I want to talk to you from a personal perspective. I want to talk about some of the mistakes maybe that I've been making, and maybe you can help me so that in the future I'm not making the same mistakes. How does that sound?
I think that sounds great. You know, the key thing I would say, I did send you a list of, you know, tips, but I'd say, you know, one huge red flag is if the candidate walks in late. And as far as I'm concerned, I mean, I live in Manhattan where it's impossible really to get anywhere on time because the traffic is so brutal here, right? But that just means that if you're a job candidate, you have to try to arrive 20 minutes early, you know? Targeting yourself to get there 20 minutes early probably means you'll walk in 5 minutes early, and that's perfect. Even if a candidate is 1 minute late, I would say it's a bad sign. It's a bad sign because this is supposed to be the candidate on their best day, all right? So if the person's a minute late or 5 minutes late on their best day, that means that they could be 15 minutes late on a day when you're sending them to see a client. So it's a really bad sign. It doesn't matter whether they call you, they text you, you know, what the excuse is, right? Of course, it's going to be something subway related probably, but it doesn't matter. That person didn't plan well enough, and you should take that into account.
Yeah, and I absolutely understand and hear what you're saying, but I want to challenge you on one thing. I want to ask you about this. In the job market today, which is very low unemployment, meaning that most of our good candidates already have a job, and when they're out, you know, looking for another to make a move, and they're trying to take time off. Oftentimes, and maybe this is where I'm making a mistake, but oftentimes I'll have them come in for a number of interviews because I want to meet with them for a number of different times. And all of a sudden, they're starting to take a lot of time off of their current job with no guarantee or promise that I'm going to hire them for this, you know, this new position. And so do you run into the situation where people just are struggling to get off enough time to get there on time?
I think that that is absolutely a reality, but I still feel that it's a red flag. I still think it's a sign. They may not be very organized. They may not think that timeliness matters, you know. It's just one of those signs. And like I said, the problem is you don't want to send that person to be with your clients or to pitch business. You can't trust that person to be on time when it really counts. So I would say if the person is late, don't hire them.
Okay. Well, we've got that on our checklist. No late employees, no late interviewees. What's the next suggestion that you have for us?
Well, you know, you can tell a lot about a person by their handshake. And if the person walks in and their handshake is weak and they're not looking at you in the eye, I would say it's probably a sign that they don't want to work there. And I would shy away from hiring that person.
Okay. And now I'm sure you've probably had this experience as well, but you know, I go in and I put my hand forward like to do a good handshake. And just for whatever reason, we're just not coordinated to the point where maybe we grab a little off a little bit. I mean, is it appropriate for me to at that point try to readjust my grip to get a good handshake in?
Well, if you were the candidate, I would say yes. You know, being the hiring person, it's not on you. Do you know what I mean? If you're the hiring person, it's not your problem how your handshake is. It's the candidate's problem. You know, the point is of a handshake is to say, basically, you know, I'm glad to be here. Thank you for having me. You know, let's get started. It should show kind of confidence and momentum, you know, going forward. That does not mean to crush the person's hand, you know, or to grip it really tight or hold on to it. It's just a firm, nice handshake. It lasts 2 seconds, and you look the person in the eye. And it's basically saying, you know, I'm happy to be here. Thank you for having me, you know.
Yeah, and one of the things I've often said, and let me see if you feel similar to this, but that it's better for us to hire for character, to hire for personality, and then train for skill, as opposed to trying to hire for skill and hope that we can train for personality or character later. What do you think about that?
I think that is huge. I think that's a great insight. I also think, though, that from a candidate's perspective, right? If you're a job candidate, you're looking for a job right now, every single other candidate that they're meeting probably has your skill set, you know? I think so often the candidates feel like it's just the skills that matter. It's like their particular talent for a particular industry that matters. And that's part of it, sure. But that's the stuff that got you to the interview. What we're talking about now is making that connection when you first walk in, the bonding moment. People make up their minds about other people in less than 60 seconds.
And once they've made that decision, it's hard to change it, right? I mean, once they've put you in a box.
Right. So, just for the listeners there, to say these sound kind of superficial. I'm the first person to admit it. However, when you know that the decision is made in less than 60 seconds, then everything is about the first impression. So the first impression, did you arrive on time or did you arrive late? Okay. Did you have a good handshake where you looked at the person in the eye or didn't you? These are first impression moments, but those are the moments that that really count in terms of getting the job.
So the other thing that I've often seen recently, and I believe this is a kind of a generational thing. And by the way, I'm Generation X. So, I grew up in a little bit different generation than the millennials, but I'm starting to see a lot of people entering the job market that come to a job interview not dressed very professionally, dressed more casually. And obviously, this is part of that first 60 seconds. But what do you think of this changing culture in the dress code? I mean, particularly, I lived in Silicon Valley for a number of years. And, being overdressed was wearing jeans to work.
So here's what I always say. First off, because I wrote a book, it's called 301 Smart Answers to Tough Interview Questions. And what I say in that book, and I live by this credo, is that the candidate should dress to be 25% more professional than they would need to be if they already had the job. So if the dress code is jeans, then the candidate should walk in nice slacks, If the dress code is nice slacks, then the candidate might want to wear nice slacks and a jacket. It's like kicking it up a notch so that the candidate is showing you, the interviewer, that they're really happy to be there, that they understand the dress code, and it's back to it's that person on their best day. So if the person, walks in shorts and that's their best day, just imagine how bad it could get, So that's what the dress code is about. It's not about, three-piece suits. Like, it depends on the corporate culture. If the culture is three-piece suits, then the candidate has to wear a three-piece suit, If it is conservative, they have to dress conservatively. If it's a little more relaxed, they can be more relaxed, but they have to be less relaxed than the average employee there that day because they are on a job interview. So they have to look a little better. And how does somebody learn all this? Well, I say, do your homework. Like, go online, research the company, find their website, see if there are any photographs of employees, see what they're wearing, see what their own employees are wearing, and then aim to dress 25% more professionally than you would need to if you were already there.
Now, would it be inappropriate for a candidate to call up and ask that question prior to the interview, like maybe ask the receptionist or the front desk support?
Right. I wouldn't do that. I mean, I think it would be better if you have a headhunter. If the candidate has a headhunter or an executive recruiter, somebody like that, that is the place to ask. Another trick is to go on LinkedIn, go on social media, see if you know somebody who works there. And ask that person, what is the dress code like on the average Tuesday, Try to find out for yourself without calling somebody that you're actually interviewing with and asking them. You know what I mean? It's not a cocktail party. It's a job interview. And part of being prepared for a job interview is knowing. You know, you should know what the dress code is. You should know what the salary is that you're going for. You know, you should know things about the team that you're going in on to meet. You know, you have to know about the person, all this stuff. Do your homework.
And I think this is a great point. I think a lot of times candidates don't do their homework. They don't take as seriously the job application and hiring process as they think that they're going to once they get the job. They hope to kind of slide in and get the job. And at that point, they're going to do their homework and do their work. And at that point, it's really too late, isn't it, Vicki?
It's too late. I mean, unfortunately, like in my book, 301 Smart Answers to Tough Interview Questions, I compare going on a job interview to going on a date. It's sort of a speed date to see if you and the company get along, right? But another way to look at it, and maybe more traditional way to look at it, is that it's also like a test, and you are trying to get an A+ on that test. So if you think about that, you know, you'll get there on time, you'll be appropriately dressed, you know, you'll know everything there is to know about that company, but still have a few interesting questions to pose.
So as you come into the interview, and I want to piggyback on what you just said here with my next question, you come in, you're dressed right, you come in 5 minutes early, you look them in the eye, shake their hand, you know you've got 60 seconds to make a connection. And so how do we now make this connection? What is the first thing that we say? How do we get the ball rolling?
Right. So in my book, I suggest an icebreaker. Now, an icebreaker is some sentence or a thought that you might have, a conversational tidbit that you can throw out to the person as you're walking down the hallway to that person's office. One trick might be if they have posters on the wall, if there's some interesting art in the reception area, just something where you can connect. Oh, I really like that statue in the reception area. Just something like that. There are more of them in my book. There are more tidbits, but just something so you break the ice. Now, breaking the ice is not the same thing as just chatter, okay? That is not, chatter is just somebody who feels very uncomfortable with silence and they're trying to fill in the silence.
The how's the weather type of conversations.
Right. The weather, I mean, if it's a hurricane, you know, then the weather is appropriate. You know what I mean? It depends what's going on outside. But if it's just like, oh, it's just so hot and humid out there, oh, blah, 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 that's terrible. And you don't want to also start the interview before you actually get to the place. So let's say you're going up, you know, in Manhattan in an office environment and you're walking a long hallway. You don't want to be talking about why you want to work there during the walk. It's like you need a little icebreaker to get you through that long walk. And it could just be a simple observation. We'll do it. It breaks the ice. But then after you've broken the ice, then you really, as a candidate, then you really need to wait and have the person who's interviewing you take the lead. Don't, as a candidate, jabber. Okay, because the person who jabbers, first of all, it's really unprofessional. Secondly, it makes you look nervous. Now, you probably are nervous, you know, because it's very harrowing to be interviewed and you probably are nervous. But the point is, it's you on your best day. So you want to show poise and that silence doesn't bother you.
And for me, a lot of this hinges on how well I prepared. You know, going into almost any situation, whether it's a job interview, whether it's a speaking event, whether it's a client call, the more preparation that you do, the more you're going to come across as confident when you're having this conversation. Let me ask you, Vicki, about a lot of times when we come into job interviews, we're brought in by the receptionist or the front desk support, you know, and they take us back into the room and get us prepared. How important is it that we are on our best behavior with the receptionist or whoever we're interacting with prior to the actual interview?
I think it is crucial to be on fantastic terms with that gatekeeper. And here's why. First of all, if you're super lucky to, and you know, if you walk in and you say hi to the receptionist and you announce yourself and you say you're here to meet so-and-so at 10 o'clock, or whatever the time is. And then she says, fine, and she asks you to take a seat. You know, don't badger her just because that person's running 15 minutes late. Don't keep hopping up and saying, are you sure that he got, you know, does he know I'm here? Does he know I'm here? Don't do that. Don't do that. It's tempting, but don't do that. Secondly, don't pull out your mobile device and try to entertain yourself for the time that you are waiting because it's going to distract you. Stay off your mobile device. You know, as a matter of fact, just put it on airplane mode during the entire interview. That means once you are there, turn it to airplane mode before you get off the elevator would be my advice. You know, what the best situation, particularly in the one you just brought up where the person is going back several times to meet with you, is in a way, just through being polite and cordial, try to befriend the gatekeeper a little bit. Like, just smile at the person. You know, don't try to engage the person in a lot of conversation, but just smile, you know, obey what she suggests, like sit down, you know, hang up your coat if it's winter, whatever it is she suggests, do, and just try to be polite because you could be lucky. Like, maybe after the interview is over, she says, I really like that person, you know, to the person who might be hiring you. It's just it could be an extra plug if you do it right. But I wouldn't try too hard, you know. Don't try to become her best friend. Just try to sort of obey what the person says.
Wonderful. Thank you for that tip. Another thing that I've started to do, and I wanted to get your take on it, and that is doing some of the second, third interviews. Like, this isn't the initial interview, but now I'm to the point where I think I'm going to hire this person, inviting them and their significant other out to a dinner meeting and having that second or third interview offsite at like a restaurant or something like that with their spouse in tow or their significant other. What do you think about that?
Okay, so I think that's very interesting. I wrote another book. It's about etiquette, and it's called 301 Smart Answers to Tough Business Etiquette Questions, and it covers things like eating in a restaurant and the etiquette, what you do as a job candidate and what you don't do as a job candidate. And I would say it's a great test, especially if you are planning to send that person out for getting new business for your company, because that person may have to wine and dine clients. And there are literally hundreds of things that that person could do wrong. People do not, you wouldn't be surprised, they don't really know how to eat, you know, like spaghetti, difficult items they don't know how to eat. Now, if you're a job candidate and this happens to you, don't order the spaghetti. Like, don't order things that are hard to eat or where you're not sure, like oysters. You know, do you use the little fork or don't you? You know what I mean? There are these things, and you know, don't order difficult items. Don't order messy items. And this is going to sound counterintuitive, but I would say do not, unless you really feel compelled to, I'd say don't bring your significant other, because you don't want the test to be about your significant other. You know, the test is about you and how you perform in this high-pressure situation, a dinner, and you want the focus to be on you, and you don't want to be worried about what your significant other might say. You know, maybe your significant other hasn't been studying the company for 2 weeks like you have, you know, and you just don't want him or her to blow it for you inadvertently. You know, another thing, I mean, it's so obvious, but another thing is don't talk about politics at the table, because you don't know, you never know who you're sitting across from, and it could really, really blow your chances.
And you don't want to make assumptions.
Right. Don't make assumptions about, you know, what the political leanings are of the interviewer. And no matter what they are, if it comes up, I would say, in a way, try to express neutrality where you can with anything connected with politics. It's just too much of a hot button, you know, today to even really get into it, especially in a job interviewing situation. I would say steer away from it. And then the question is, what do you talk about? Well, I would say talk about neutral things that are fun. It might be interesting. I always recommend that people try to learn what the hobbies are of the people who are interviewing them. You know, learn something about the person that's not business related so that you can go to that as a conversation if need be.
And this has become easier today with things like LinkedIn and other social media where you can actually check in on the person that you're interviewing with and see maybe a picture of them doing some activity or at a sporting event or, you know, at the opera or whatever may be their interest. Now, I want to go back just really quickly from the other side. Now, you're interviewing, you're not the interviewee, but you're the job poster that wants to hire this candidate. You know, I like to have the spouse come because I like to see oftentimes when the spouse or the significant other is there, their guard is down a little bit and you can start to read into the personality a little bit better or a little bit differently than you can in a formalized when somebody's buttoned up and on their best behavior.
I think it's true what you're saying. And I'm also going to say to any job candidates out there, if you're going to do that, you really have to almost train your spouse or your significant other in what to say, what not to say. It's almost like you have to grill the person so that you're a team, you're pulling together, you know. I always say in my various books, you know, don't bring your significant other or your spouse to an office party either for the same reason. It's not nothing against the significant others out there. It's just that, you know, to do it, you want to be you at your best. And when you bring another person, it changes the whole equation. And now both of you have to be a collective you at your best. And it's just harder. Not to say you can't do it, but it's more difficult. And you need to sort of train the other person, you know. Let's say you're staying away from politics, but your significant other is pounding the table, you know. That's not good, okay? Don't let that person do that.
Okay. Well, hey, look, I'm looking at a little bit of our time here, and I want to make sure that we end on time. But before we get to that, I wanted to ask you a question that from two different perspectives. One is, I know you've written these books, 301 interview questions to prepare for and be ready for. I want to ask you, what is a very common interview question that people struggle with? And then on the flip side, I want to ask the same question, but from an interviewer's perspective, what's a great question that we should be asking in every job interview?
Okay, so I say if the candidate has holes in her or his resume, I feel that it is appropriate for the interviewer to ask that question.
And by holes, you mean periods of unemployment or periods of nothingness. Yeah.
Yes. Like maybe you notice that the person has organized their resume by the years that they spent at companies rather than the specific dates. You know, they're not using the months. That's fine. But maybe when you see the dates, you see, oh, there's a year skipped, you know, or something like that. I think it's appropriate to ask, I see that there's a hole in your resume. You know, you weren't employed, you weren't working. It looks like you weren't working from this day to this day. What were you doing? You know, because, and I think that's also just the same question. I think it should be asked, but I also think that that can be sort of a hard question. If somebody was unemployed, let's say they were looking for a job for a year, and that's what they were basically doing that year. They were looking for a job, right? But if you're the job candidate, you also need to say what else you were doing during that year. You were looking for a job, of course, but you were also doing volunteer work, improving your skills, you joined Toastmasters, something like that that shows that you were improving your skills during the time off.
And so if you happen to be going through a period of time off right now, Vicki, would you recommend that we start to take some continuing education or join Toastmasters or do some stuff that will now give us some of those responses and answers when we, because we are going to get that question, right? I mean, almost every interviewer is going to want to know what the gaps in your resume are from and for.
You are going to get the question, most likely. You should be prepared to answer it. And I think it's a stronger answer. I personally think it's a stronger answer if it's that you are doing volunteer work, and in your volunteer work, you know, you have mastered these skills that you can bring forward. You know, it's also the type of thing, like if you're a female and you took time off, maybe you took time off to raise children or something like that, even more so, if you took several years off, you know, there should be something additional that you've been doing. Raising kids is great, but it should also be that you did something else. You joined this organization, you learned this, you have kept up with technology and social media during the time off. And these are the things you need to sort of prove to the person who's asking you about this.
Yeah, and the burden shifts to you as the interviewee to answer these type of questions, because they're going to be there. And this is part of the process of preparing for the interview, is to understand and recognize that these are the questions that you're going to be asked. And the burden shifts to you to answer them, not for the interviewer to try to pull them out of you.
Right, right. And if you've taken, a lot of time off, or if you have several holes in your resume, you really have to think about it and plot out your answers. And I always advise people, let's say you get the interview offer today. Somebody says, okay, we want you to come in. Can you come in tomorrow? Your first response is going to be sure, right? Because you want to get the interview over with. But the better thing to do is to try to give yourself a few days to really study the company, study yourself, think about the questions that you are likely to be asked, prepare your answers, think about the questions that you want to ask your interviewer, prepare those questions, and then practice, because you cannot pull out a piece of paper during the job interview and read your notes. You just have to memorize it, basically. And so give yourself the time that you need to practice and shine in that interview.
And does this ever end up as a detriment in that, they're interviewing 10 people, 6 people, and now all of a sudden you're at the end of the line, they've seen everybody. Does it end up as a detriment that you're now a comparison to them, as opposed to you, instead of you being the barometer, you become just a measurement against what everybody else is?
There are certain studies on this, right? And I look at it from two different perspectives, and sometimes the perspectives clash. So first perspective is certain days are just better for job interviews, okay? Like a Tuesday is a better day to go on a job interview than a Friday, all right? No matter what number you are in the line, you would rather be on a Tuesday than a Friday, because Fridays, people want to get out. Maybe they have summer Fridays. Maybe they only have half-day Fridays. Fridays, everybody wants to get everything off their desk. Friday's a terrible day to go on a job interview. Also, I know in this economy, we don't have to worry about it too much, but Fridays are also the day that people are usually fired. Also, you don't want to be interviewing on a Friday, right? So try to get your interview. I would say Tuesday is a good day, or Wednesday is a great day. So that's part of it. That said, you need enough time to study. Now, if you can be first in the line of interviewees and you have enough time to study, I would go for the first position if you can, let's say you have a headhunter and the headhunter says they're going to interview 10 people and you say, can I be first? The answer is you want to be first if you still have time to study for the company. But if you don't have the time, then I'd rather be last, because then with the extra time you spend it studying the company and you can blow away everybody else and be the last person that they remember seeing. You can shine. So I'd say first or last are the two slots you want to aim for.
I think this is a great suggestion, Vicki. And, we've only talked about one or two of the 301 or probably infinity of different topics around this that we could talk about. But because of our time, I want to shift gears and run to the last section of the podcast. This is Learning from Leaders, where we tie a little bit of personal in with this business conversation. Does that sound okay?
Sure.
All right. How about the book currently on your Kindle or bedside table? What are you reading?
Okay. I just finished a book by Ann Tolstoy Wallach. It is not nonfiction. It's fiction. It's called Women's Work. I read that this author had recently died, and she wrote this great book about the advertising business, a novel. And I used to be in the advertising business, and I just finished it. I thought it was fabulous.
And so this, you're saying, is a fiction book, but it has business principles, or it has advertising foundation?
It has advertising people, characters in it, and it's sort of an interesting, I find it unbelievably interesting, having been in the field myself and having also written about it. I found it unbelievably accurate and interesting, but it is a novel, just FYI, a novel.
Well, and I often recommend reading a novel before bed anyway. It helps to turn off my, for me personally, it helps turn off my business brain and allow my brain to sleep more deeply. So we love getting fictional books as far as recommendations go. Our next question then is your leadership superpower.
I think I trust my gut, and I think I really listen to my instinct. And I think when you are, especially if you're job interviewing, right now, I say a lot of times you just know, like, how it went, whether you click, everything. You know everything already. And I think I've just learned how to key into my instinct.
And I think this is a great suggestion, no matter what side of the table you're sitting on in the job interview process, trust your gut. If you don't feel like this is a company that you're going to be happy with long term, it's better to know that today in the job interview than tomorrow and your first assignment. On the flip side, you're on the other side of the desk. If this candidate just doesn't feel right, even if you can't put your finger on exactly why this candidate doesn't feel right to you, trust your gut, and there's a lot of candidates out there. Make sure that you feel comfortable, because like you said, this is they're supposed to be on their best behavior during the interview process, their very best day. And if they're not meeting up to your standards and what you're looking for, it's not going to be a long-term good relationship. Next question, how about your favorite philosophy, mantra, or quote, something that you live by?
Well, I just love the book, the old book by Dale Carnegie, How to Win Friends and Influence People. And Dale Carnegie always says, people really hate criticism. And I think that that is just a great little tidbit to keep in mind, you know? Like, let's say you are walking down that hallway and you're looking for something to say, and you see this horrible poster on the wall, you know? Don't scrunch up your face and say, ew, why is that on the wall, you know? Because it's sort of criticizing the company, but it's in a weird way, it's also criticizing the person for working there, you know? You just want to not criticize people. Now, chances are, you know, you might have to give feedback, but you have to think about how to do it. You just negative, demoralizing feedback is something nobody ever wants to hear. So just try to keep that in mind.
And it's not constructive. It's not building the relationship. There are times and places for criticism, like in a review, not criticism, but constructive feedback in like a review process, but not when you're standing in the hallway of an interview. The final question then is the best book ever written or the book that you gift to your friends, colleagues, and family.
Well, I do like Dale Carnegie's How to Win Friends and Influence People. I think that's a really just a great little book. I also took the course, and I was fascinated that the course, I was worried that it would be too old-fashioned, you know, because that book was written in the 1930s. But the course is not old-fashioned, and the book is great, and I just think it should just be on everybody's library.
Timeless principles. Well, Vicki, sure appreciate you coming on the show today. These are topics that are right at the forefront of my mind right now. I do a lot of hiring, as I mentioned at the top of the hour, and this is great, interesting topic to jump into. Before we let you go, how can we find out more about you and pick up a copy of a number of your books?
Okay. My name is Vicki Oliver. My website is VickiOliver.com. Vicki is V-I-C-K-Y. And my books are all available on Amazon, BN.com, and other places where books are sold, like bookstores, 301 Smart Answers to Tough Interview Questions, and I've written 4 other books. Anyway, more info there on my website, lots of articles too.
Wonderful. Well, Vicki, we're going to link all of that up on the show notes for this episode so the listeners can just go there, click on it, and discover more about you. You are such a great expert to have on the show. Sure appreciated spending the time with you. Thank you for being this week's guest expert.
Thank you for having me. I really appreciate being on the show.
All right, my friends, what did you think of that? I hope that you enjoyed our little sit down with Vicki Oliver. Sure appreciate her coming on and sharing her expertise in a topic that is so timely right now for me. As I deal with a lot of my coaching clients, the number one thing that I see holding back their business is their ability to bring in the right candidate at the right time. Their ability to hire out, because you see, bringing on somebody shouldn't be an expense for your company. It should be an investment that returns greater than the investment in the long term. And by long term, I mean after 30 days. And so as I look at this and I look at the coaching clients that I deal with and the conversations that we have, the number one thing that we find is how do we get good people and how do we make sure that we keep the wrong people out of our company? And so as we dove into some of the 301 interview questions and things to look for, I hope that you have some valuable takeaways. Some of it's pretty obvious, right? Be on time, dress right, but you'll be amazed at how many people don't follow those simple instructions. And you'll be amazed at how many times you'll try to talk yourself into just saying, well, I know the subway was running late and therefore it's not their fault. But really, we need to set these parameters in the very beginning, understand the type of candidate that we're looking for, and trust our gut to know that this is the right person to be long-term for our company. Somebody that's going to help take us to the next level. Of course, everything that we talked about in this episode can be found on the show notes, found at jakeacarlson.com/ML84, episode 84. And until next week, I want to wish you the very best of days, an even better life, and of course, stay awesome. Thanks for listening to the Modern Leadership Podcast. You can find me on Facebook at Speaker Jake, on Twitter at Jake A. Carlson, and of course the website, jakeacarlson.com. See you there.